It's good to see you all here this evening. I am Emily Towns. On my best days, the Dean of the Divinity School. And on my worst days, the Dean of the Divinity School. But I'd like to welcome all those here and those watching via live stream, and those who will watch in the archives of the 2015 Cole Lectureship. This lectureship was established in 1893 by Colonel E.W. Cole of Nashville to bring distinguished lecturers to the campus in, quote, defense and advocacy of the Christian religion. Among the distinguished church leaders and theologians who have delivered the Cole lectures over the last 123 years are Harry Emerson Fosdick, Paul Tillich, H. Richard Niebuhr, Fred Craddock, Elizabeth Schussler Fiorenza, Albert Rabiteau, Gustavo Gutierrez, James Cone, Don Beiswinger, Ed Farley, David Buttrick, Marcus Borg, Jürgen Moltmann, Peter Gomes, Jim Wallace, James Lawson, John W. O'Malley, S.J., and Elaine Pagels, to name a few. This year, the Cole Lectures are part of the Transformative Justice, Culture, Race, and Movement series, a new partnership between Vanderbilt Divinity School and Skerritt Bennett Center that offers laity and clergy the opportunity to explore different ways to combine leadership development through justice making, through lectures by poets and writers, workshops on social change, other artistic media, and a civil rights immersion in the spring. This partnership draws on the expertise of both institutions and their historic commitments to offer people of faith resources for building a more just and faithful future. This year's co-lecturer is Nikky Finney. One of my favorite descriptions of her is that she has been writing for as long as she has memory. Raised in the small fishing and farming community of Conway, South Carolina, and educated at Talladega College and Atlanta University, she is a Southern woman with the sense and sensibilities of those who grow up appreciating loving rice and words and water and the land and the stars. Nikki has also traveled north and west to places like Yale and Brandeis, and the University of Rochester, Notre Dame, Oberlin, the Art Institute of Chicago, Ohio State, Mills and Smith Colleges, with words as her invitation to see the world not only as it is, but how it can be and perhaps should be. She is also, as we will soon hear, an educator and lecturer in Jamaica at the Calabash International Literary Festival, the International Black Women's Film Festival in Denver, the Jacob Lawrence panel at the University of Kentucky, and the Alice Walker and National Black Women's Health Project in DC, the International Photo Festival in Houston, and on and on and on. Her poetry, essays, interviews, and videos have appeared in over 15 anthologies and on film. She was awarded an honorary doctorate of humanities by Claflin University, and among her many awards is the Pan American Open Book Award for her collection, Rice, in 1999, and the Kentucky Foundation for Women Artists Fellowship Award. Her fourth collection of poetry, Head Off and Split, won the 2011 National Poetry Award. If you have not heard her acceptance speech, and you have heard her poetry, go to YouTube and search for Nikky Finney National Book Acceptance Award. It was and remains a work of fierce art. As a founding member of the Affrilachian Poets Collective and a faculty member of Cave Canem, she is in demand as a workshop faculty member on panels and as a judge. In 2013, the Clarice Smith Center of the University of Maryland commissioned her The Battle of and for the Black-Faced Boy, a radical libretto, to commemorate the sesquicentennial of the end of the Civil War. 15 pages in length, the poem represents an original vision of what Finney calls a radical libretto, as it draws from modernism to move between centuries and travels across the ocean highway of the transatlantic slave trade and throughout the United States. If I have now piqued your interest about the poem, you can find it in the fall 2015 issue of Oxford American. I invite you to join me in welcoming back to Vanderbilt the John H. Bennett Jr. Endowed Professor of Creative Writing and Southern Letters at the University of South Carolina, Nikky Finney, as this year's co-lecturer. Immediately following tonight's lecture, we invite you to join us for a sumptuous reception in the reading room. However, before we get to food and drink, there is the kind of thought we need to do before. The title and theme of Finney's lectures this year, A Young Black Woman Shimmy and Shakes a Flagpole, finally brings the Confederate flag down after 100 years, colon. Thoughts on climbing, not waiting on the Calvary, faith and manners in the contemporary South. I can't wait. And I have done a great job in not asking, what in the world are you going to do? It is my great honor and joy to welcome you, Nikky Finney, friend, colleague, and poet, lover of words, writer of truth, to this time and place and space with us. Let us begin.
Trying to show out.
I took the top off the water bottle.
Okay. Good evening. I feel like I've stepped into a capsule. Dean Towns, thank you so much for the invitation. I have been greatly looking forward to stepping into this capsule and speaking with you about a topic that was running through my mind. And as soon as I got the invitation, I knew immediately what I wanted to talk about. My life happens like that. Most of the things that I work on are never too far away from me. I just need the invitation to sit down and make sense of it all. Hopefully I've done that. If you couldn't tell by the length of the title, I am a daughter of Intozaki Shange. And I hope the title does justice to the long, beautiful title of her own work. A young black woman shimmy and shakes a flagpole and finally brings the Confederate flag down after 100 years. Thoughts on climbing, not waiting on the Calvary, faith and manners in the contemporary South. Epigraph 1. You can pray until you faint, but unless you get up and try to do something, God is not going to put it in your lap, Fannie Lou Hamer. Epigraph 2. One of the things that has to be faced is the process of waiting to change the system. How much we have got to do to find out who we are, where we have come from, and where we are going. Ella Baker. I begin this talk by telling you who I am and what I deeply believe in by choosing the words of two black women to highlight and open the door for the rest of my words. Two black women who taught me to keep searching my heart until I put my hands and arms around what matters. And I am also letting you know now that I will end this talk with the words of a black man who singularly taught me to not be afraid to call God's name and say what I need to say about that name, and to not be afraid of being hit by lightning in the saying, as long as I'm saying what I need to say with great love. I begin this talk by assuring you that the great state of South Carolina has not fallen into the sea. Even as I am one of its proud but petulant daughters, family and community are holding on and helping each other and fighting for a way up and out of the raging, long memory waters of the Congaree and the Suwannee. The dark energy and the dark matter. Scientists tell us that our amazing universe is 13.7 billion years old. They say the expansion of our old and great universe is not slowing down, but instead expanding, speeding up even. We owe our knowledge of this physical and astronomical understanding to the great Hubble telescope that was placed in the heavens over 25 years ago, providing an altogether new set of close, paying attention electronic eyes. The Hubble over time became a tape measure, if you will, a ruler for the universe, a way to measure things we could never see or take in with great acuity before. What are the forces fueling the expansion of the universe? There are several scenarios being discussed, the things we know and the things we don't. I am drawn to both, but mainly the unknown. There is dark matter and there is dark energy. Great and mysterious scientific forces of the universe. Our universe may contain 100 to 200 billion galaxies, each with billions of stars, great clouds of gas and dust, and perhaps scads of planets and moons and other little bits of cosmic flotsam. The stars produce an abundance of energy from radio waves to X-rays, which streak across the universe at the speed of light. Yet everything we can see is like the tip of the cosmic iceberg. It accounts for only about 4% of the total mass and energy found in the universe. I know I've come to talk with true believers, but as the Baptist preacher might say to the professor of astronomy, stay with me now. About one quarter of the universe consists of dark matter, which releases no detectable energy, but which exerts a gravitational pull on all the visible matter in the universe. Because of the names, it's easy to confuse dark matter and dark energy. And while they may be related, the effects, their effects, are quite different. In brief, dark matter attracts, dark energy repels. While dark matter pulls matter inward, dark energy pulls it outward. Also, while dark energy shows itself only on the largest cosmic scale, dark matter exerts its influence on individual galaxies as well as the universe at large. In fact, astronomers discovered dark matter while studying the outer regions of our galaxy, the Milky Way. There are those in the know who say that dark energy is the most important stuff in the universe. We don't know exactly what dark energy is. We don't know exactly where it comes from. Very mysterious, this dark energy. Dark matter is a non-luminous material that exists in space that could take any of several forms. It could take the form of weak interacting particles, or it could also take the form of high energy particles. The universe of dark things. If I had a blackboard up here, I'm prone to being the teacher that I am, and a piece of chalk, not a whiteboard, this is what I would write. Dark matter, 21% of the universe. Dark energy, 74% of the universe. Normal matter, 4%. But that's only 99%. Where is the other one? I was raised to care about all of humanity, all. But I was also reared to see myself, one tiny sacred dark girl star in the galaxy, as valuable and impactful, even if nobody else saw me that way. I was instructed and constructed by both school teacher and carpenter alike to especially care about other familial dark stars in my galaxy, because in a world that specialized in disregarding black stars and moons and suns, if I didn't pay attention to this tribe and family of luminous human beings, why, who would? I am drawn to this mysterious dark matter and energy, period. I find myself staring at the night sky all the time, thinking about it quite a bit. There are so many things in our lexicon that have the word dark in it or attached to it that do not immediately bring to mind, that do bring to mind something evil or sinister. I even made myself a sweatshirt once. I still have it. I cut out the letters dark matter on the front and the back. I write in that shirt, dark matter, that's me. I was going to wear it tonight, but I promised Dean Towns that I would keep to the cold lecture dress protocol. I do find myself one dark girl in the world thinking a lot about dark energy, attributing and aligning its powers to other dark girls and boys. Sometimes those boys and girls are human beings that cannot see their dark energy power. Sometimes their dark matter power is interpreted as evil and dubious. Sometimes, like me, they have to be able to hold on to it and climb up inside of it. The gravity that makes up dark matter is so strong that nothing can escape. And because this sweet dark matter is so deliciously black, we can take no photograph of it. All we can do, as far as dark matter is concerned, is get close enough to it to know and feel that it is there working and doing its magic in bringing us closer. We used the great Hubble telescope to see black holes for the first time. This is what NASA reported, quote, "Now more is unknown than known. We don't know what it is, but we know how much of it there is. We know how much dark energy there is because we know how it affects the universe's expansion. Other than that, it is a complete mystery." When I left South Carolina at the age of 17, I always returned to see my family, but I never had any desire to live there again. Not if the Confederate flag, symbol of hatred, murder, and ongoing oppression, was still flying there, as it had flown there when I was a girl. The Confederate flag represented to me hatred, violence, and it was everywhere around me, visually and emotionally. I had spent my life sitting just inches behind boys who wore it on their faded denim jackets in chemistry class. My mother would pull up behind rattling trucks that had it pasted on their back windows. And there were those barbecue joints who flew it from the rooftops. I had watched it flap and wave for 17 long years in the good wind of South Carolina. I made a youthful but firm decision that I did not want to spend the rest of my life watching it continue to bleed over a state that could not seem to let go of the unequivocal treason and horror that it represented in so many of our minds. 2 years ago, when the University of South Carolina invited me home to accept the John H. Bennett Chair in Creative Writing and Southern Studies, after thinking about the reasons to go or not to go, my thoughts landed on the Confederate flag one night, how it had been moved, for sure, but not terribly far, and how it was still flying high on the Capitol grounds in Columbia, even after the long, passionate fight of so many dedicated people to bring it down. But those passionate voices had gone unheard. The governors and the lawmakers had not considered their intimate point of view. After all, they were only the children of those whose freedom and lives the Civil War had been fought over. In the final decision, I chose the needs of my aging mother and father over any ongoing protest about a flag. Honor thy father and thy mother so that the days. So I moved back home, a daughter of South Carolina that had been gone for almost 40 years, and I kept my feelings about the Confederate flag close but quiet. As a girl growing up in Conway in Sumter, South Carolina, my mother was one of those black women you did not disregard or ignore. She was of that generation, one of that temperament who commanded then and now a power and grace like few others in my world. My mother's physical presence easily took the breath out of the room whenever she entered. Her own personal understanding of who she was and the respect she had for her own life was legendary. My mother had been raised by taskmasters and disciplinarians and school teachers who reeled off black family history and taught etiquette at the dinner table every night, people who insisted on manners from their children as a way of life. Alongside her temperament and power, my mother was and still is the most beautiful woman in the world. She would walk into Edwards Five and Dime department store, Sumter, South Carolina, to buy a bag of clothespins or a pack of undershirts for daddy. Mama would be dressed to the nines in a baby blue polka-dotted sleeveless dress, cinched at the waist, arms freshly lotioned or Vaselined, her whole black woman body shining like a bronze action figure. She would stand there like Dorothy Dandridge or Lena Horne, off screen, waiting to be waited on. And even with all of that, no white clerk working in the store looked or came our way to wait on us or take our good green money from our dark hands. If my mother waited longer than she felt reasonable, well, that's when I would begin to get a little nervous, because I knew the air in the pretty store was about to change and be compromised by my mother's long and lotioned, beautiful, unfurled arm reaching up and waving in the air for the attention of the store's manager. Dutifully, before he arrived, my mother would pull me into position directly in front of her. All I could see when I looked up was only, my mother's beautiful black arm high in the air above me, refusing to come down. The bare braids of deltoid, bicept, and coneus radiating high in the air above me, like the black flag of some good country with no name. Mama was one part rocket, two parts sunbeam, three parts cavalry, four parts Calvary. I hail proudly from black women who know and use their arms, black women who knew America would not be America without their useful working arms, women who did not hide their arms, who carried their arms brazenly, and sometimes, because it was the only work they could get at the time, lost an arm working at the chicken or flashlight factory. I hailed from women who seemed to like their arms very much, no matter what size they were, who needed their arms when they had nothing else to call on but the power of their own bodies, holding out their arms to shield someone or hold someone they loved close. Women who believed that their useful, necessary black arms had to breathe, stay free, be quick to open, stay ready to fly. These were women who knew that free black arms had the power to swim upstream, climb a hill when necessary, break a fall, propel and dance, climb a flagpole if needed, and take something hideous down without permission. Even arm wrestle foolishness if need be. Babies had to be held, hugging had to happen, women holding up signs that read, quote, a man was lynched today, end quote. Or, until the killing of black men, black mothers' sons is as important as the killing of white sons, white mothers' sons. Or, this flag is not about history, it is about hate. The black arms of the black women of so many black families that drove buses and carried weighty purses that doubled as hammerheads, black female arms that knew a roadblock when they saw one and knew it might have to come down before the end of the day. Black arms on black women are critical, valuable apparatuses used for escaping, pointing towards the North Star, toward freedom, folded all night in prayer and thanksgiving, penciling notes on women's suffrage, and documenting the horrors of lynching, gesticulating the way to hold the right fork, or lay a napkin across the lap, or dab the corner of a mouth, or reach for the hem of a hateful flag. America the Beautiful knows the black arms of black women very well. America the Beautiful calls many of us angry black women if we display our black bare arms or use them for more than serving sweet potato casserole or sweeping from field to bathroom. But we women of dark matter and dark energy are not afraid to use our black and bare arms in the service of the greater good. We use our arms to wave at each other, hold our children, our sweethearts, and like other animals of the highest order, we use our arms to help ourselves and others move both vertically and horizontally into the next dimension. Black amber, caramel, elegant, muscular, long and pillow-like, with our black arms akimboed at our hips or side. American history has never acknowledged the power and presence of the black arms of black women. They have needed our black arms to keep the house nice, but at every turn, they have arrested our black arms when we get out of line and make our move to shimmy the flagpole in order to remove one of the great vestiges of hate in the land. They wait to fold our sweet black arms back behind us, the black arms of black women, great and magnificent weapons of pure dark energy. My mother was an only girl in a family of two boys. I am the only girl in a family of two boys. My mother's people were farmers, people who rose before the sun and went to bed when the sun went to bed. Everybody knew hard work and called it by its first name. Everybody knew sweat and sacrifice. My grandfather kept the books in the tiny country church they belonged to. My grandmother played the piano. Her favorite song near the end of her life was, "I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary." Whenever she uttered the word Calvary, she would close her eyes as if it was one of those black women words that just could not be spoken with eyes open. I knew it to be one of her most sacred words. The values and manners that my grandparents taught my mother as a girl were taught to me as a girl growing up beneath the Confederate flag. I had dreamed of climbing that flagpole one day, dreamed of bringing it down myself. I was a black girl weighed down by all the manners and propriety I had been taught. Propriety is the state or quality of conforming to conventionally accepted standards of behavior or morals. I grew into the feet and language of a good girl, because my family set that marker in front of me as the thing that I should most aspire to. When I was a child, I obeyed my mother and father because it was one of the commandments that I learned in Sunday school and church. Even though I didn't know the word propriety when I was a girl, I certainly felt I knew what it meant in my bones. It wasn't until I began to dream of leaving South Carolina and the Confederate flag and my thoughts as a child that I began to dream outside those lines. Not until then did I understand that the good girl of me was someone that the people who had not won the Civil War counted on me being. I had found one of the most difficult things in the world to change about myself was to shed the weight of my manners and the knowledge of propriety. What did those mothers believe we would need those manners for? How did our mothers who taught us those manners and propriety think our understanding of manners and politeness would help us out in the long run of our lives? Did they believe it would save us, separate us, shelter us, keep us safe and quiet? Sometimes when my grandmother played and sang, "I Believe in a Hill Called Mount Calvary," on her twanging out of tune piano, it was in church. Sometimes she would hum it alone in her yard as she planted her mums, begonias, and petunias. When she talked about this physical place, also known as Golgotha, translated to mean the place of the skull, because in early biblical writings it was a hill that resembled a skull's cap. This is where, according to Christian belief and teaching, my grandmother's Jesus was nailed to the cross, where he died for her, where he suffered for the sins of the world, where he must have called out to his Father in heaven this word, Calvary. When spoken by her, it would transform her into another dimension of herself. The same word, Calvary, surely was known and called upon and believed in by the 9 parishioners of Mount Emmanuel Church in Charleston, South Carolina, as well, right before they were assassinated. And when they were to come to the place which is called Calvary, they crucified him there, and the robbers, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Calvary, not cavalry. Cavalry, not Calvary. Cavalry is a French word. When I was a girl, I loved cowboy movies because of all the action. I loved the bugle call for the cavalry. I loved how high up the cavalry sat on their horses. I loved the drama and energy of men on their white horses with rifles drawn. It would be many years before I read about the history of cavalries and how far back in time they stretched. Many years before I would understand that the power of a cavalry had everything to do with the freedom of mobility, the freedom to move as one fought. Putting soldiers on horseback and making a cavalry had everything to do with being higher up than the person one was fighting there on the ground. It had everything to do with not being hemmed in and having the decided advantage of height, speed, and inertia on your side. When I was little and didn't know better, I believed in waiting, waiting to be saved, waiting for someone to come and help me, waiting for a cavalry that never ever came. The cavalry that came and rescued those on TV never came for me. The cavalry that slaughtered the Indians was never meant to protect me and keep me safe. It would be many years before I figured out the historical lies, power, and illusion of that RCA Victor television set. For many years, as I grew into my poet's clothes, I would mix up the spelling of my grandmother's Calvary with my black girl's cavalry. One little L out of place can make all the difference in the world. Later on, when I aligned the two drastically different spellings with their drastically different definitions, it was too late. The ink had been cast, and I was hurling through the galaxy as a poet who loved the dark matter, mysterious, unphotographable space between the two words. I have always been drawn to poetry because of how words line up and brush against each other and make dark energy. These two words, once found, remained in my energy zone. One day I said, I will deliver the Cole lecture at Vanderbilt. And I will talk about these two words. I was just checking to make sure you were with me. In the many weeks after Vanderbilt announced that I was coming to deliver this lecture, a long list of friends and aunts, very persnickety folks, folks who know language, they all wrote to me, one after the other. Dear Nikki, please ask Vanderbilt to correct the poster. Surely it is a mistake. No, I would tell them, it's not a mistake. The poet is working inside new galaxies. A poet is listening to the dark energy that words can make. My grandmother's personal way of providing emphasis for things was to put a the in front of whatever word she needed to emphasize to me. Darling, she would say, I'm singing about the Calvary. Girl, she would say, do you know anything about Calvary? And then she would walk out of the room, not waiting for my response. Or she would say, I'm praying hard on the understanding. Then she would say, you young people are living on the extremity, you know. Yes, she would change syntax, anything she cared about, any word she pleased, to whatever she needed it to be in the moment. She was polite, but impolite in the same breath. Adding prefixes and suffixes, making nouns, verbs, and adding an unusual infinitive, standard fare. She didn't wait for permission from others in order to emphasize what she felt in her heart needed emphasizing then and there. Black women are so complicated. Beulah, Lenora, Butler, Davenport had a brilliant original mind that had not been corrupted by too much Western education. She considered her own belly and mind and Jesus the most reliable sources of information. I loved this about her. It taught me something intrinsic and valuable as a girl that I would later need and use as a woman writer. I loved to climb things when I was a girl, but I wasn't encouraged to climb physical things. It wasn't ladylike, you know. But still, I loved the act of doing so on my own. I wanted to follow my brothers up every tree, but usually that was not allowed. What was up there, I wondered. What was as high as the chinaberry tree in our yard? Was that as high as the cavalry rode on their horses? Was it as high up as the cross that stood at Calvary? Was anything higher? I wanted to know, but I didn't get many opportunities to find out because some adult was always stopping me. I was a girl and not supposed to climb. My place, I was told, was on the ground. I was supposed to remain on the ground, perpetually looking up, just up under the skirt tail of wonder, gazing into the face of dark energy, but never joining it personally. We live in a bright, modern 21st century world where so many girls find themselves in the middle of a blistering civil war, and where black and brown girls find themselves battling the same violence that black and brown boys battle, but so far off screen of humanity that nobody ever reports all the kinds of harm being done to them. Quietly at home sometimes, publicly in school systems sometimes, loudly in the streets sometimes. Black girls are living and fighting in a modern day civil war with our America the Beautiful. Everybody want to go to heaven, a blues man once wrote, but nobody wants to die. Once upon a time, a young black woman much younger than me, with far more courage than me, who had also been taught grace and manners in her life, decided one day to get dressed one day and pull up the sleeves of her long black woman arms and go out into the world and take up the mantle of Ella Baker and Fannie Lou Hamer's words. She decided to raise her hand there in the secret circle of her own tribe and volunteer to be the one to climb the flagpole and take down the Confederate flag. On June 27, 2015, 10 days after 9 human beings who believed fiercely in Calvary, Christians, sons, mothers, daughters, wives, grandmothers, all, were assassinated in their Mother Emanuel Church while in prayer meeting. Bree Newsom donned her climbing helmet just like it was some kind of space-age Octavia Butler Easter bonnet. And if you don't know who Octavia Butler is, you have your homework assignment before you. Wait, let me say that again. Bree Newsom, I like that line, I made that up. That's totally mine. Bree Newsom donned her climbing helmet like it was some kind of space-age Octavia Butler Easter bonnet along with her climbing gear. She had been doing a lot of thinking lately and a lot of praying. 9 human beings had been assassinated while they closed their eyes just as they said one final prayer for the evening, for the night, with their new visitor who had walked in from the street, who had joined them for prayer circle. The Confederate flag flying above the South Carolina State House had not been lowered in respect for them like other flags around the state and the nation. It was still flying as usual over the Confederate memorial on the Capitol grounds. Bree's friend, Jimmy Tyler, a young white freedom fighter in that same secret meeting, stepped forward and raised his hand and said he would spot for Bree as she climbed the flagpole. Why? Because he said he believed white people had to put some skin in the game in order to eradicate racism and white supremacy. Skin in the game? Skin in the game. Skin in the game. The funerals in Charleston were happening one by one. That Friday night, June 26, during the eulogy for Reverend Pinckney in Charleston, President Obama said, quote, "Removing the flag would not be an act of political correctness. Removing the flag would not be an insult to the valor of Confederate soldiers. It would simply be an acknowledgement that the cause for which the Confederates fought, the cause of slavery, was wrong." And by taking down the flag, President Obama said, "We express God's grace." God's grace. God's grace. God's grace. Skin in the game. God's grace. God's grace. Skin in the game. Dark matter started moving all through the air that night. In the dark heart of one dark girl, raised with manners and kindness, but also raised in the spirit and energy of Christian revolutionary action theology. Bree Newsom of Charlotte, North Carolina, a black girl from the South, whose ancestors came to America through a slave port in Charleston, decides with her Octavia Butler Easter bonnet, helmet on, and climbing gear nearby that it was rude and it was disrespectful and it was downright mannerless and simply not nice for the Confederate flag to be flying over the state capitol while the body of Reverend Pinckney arrives to lie in state. She did her research. She's a young woman who knows her history. She understands that laws are laws. She also knows that some laws are unjust and must be challenged. So Bree Newsom of Charlotte, North Carolina, refuses to be ruled by the intimidation and fear that the Confederate flag had over thousands of little black girls from the South for 150 years and more. She called the 9 murders a terrorist attack against black people in this country and not just another shooting. She decides with her manners in tow that she is willing to be charged with defacing public property because she believes the Confederate flag has been defacing the face of South Carolina and the hearts and minds of black people, as well as a lot of other good people for many, many years. The young black woman named Brittany Ann Byerium, and called Bree for short, has deeply inherited her black woman arms and her billions of light years of dark matter and dark energy, and she's only 30 years old. She knows her history. She wants to know her future. She has grown up with the same symbol of hate as others before her, but she makes an entirely different decision that none of us had ever made before. At 6 a.m. on Saturday morning, June 27th, just as the police guards at the Capitol leave the front of the building on their rounds, with the help of her young white friend, Jimmy, who believes that other white people need to put some skin in the game if racism is to ever be a thing of the past, kindly, politely helps her shimmy up the pole toward her future and ours. Bree Newsom, with her long, beautiful black woman arm, stretches up the flagpole vertically towards Calvary with the help of 60 million or more. Thank you, Toni Morrison. The young woman from Charlotte, North Carolina, makes the climb just as the police officers come running. She gently touches the flag that she finds criminal and disrespectful. The police are below her when she does. Jimmy is there telling them politely and with kindness, just let her come down. We have not come to cause any trouble or hurt your flag. And that is when Bree, now with the Confederate flag unhooked from the steel carabiner, and for a minute it flutters in the wind. And then carefully and gingerly and gently in her grasp, in her kind hands, she screams out, what I believe can be heard all the way to Calvary. Quote, you come against me in the name of hatred, oppression, and violence, but I come against you in the name of God. This flag comes down today. End quote. The rude, disrespectful, hate-filled flag that the young black woman dressed in Octavia Butler Easter bonnet, headdress, helmet has unhooked from history is held carefully in her hands with the greatest kindness. She knows she is protected by the cavalry of 60 million or more formerly enslaved Africans who accompanied her every inch of the way up that pole. And so, all the way down the pole, she is calm, cool, and polite. The same Confederate flag in her hands that has been sewn on the back of denim jackets and in the back of truck windows and flown in the sweet barbecue air of South Carolina in the name of 9 assassinations at Mother Emanuel and thousands of killings and hangings and rapes and more. Bree Newsom's Southern manners were showing that day. Nevertheless, she will be criticized by black and white alike. People will say how disrespectful it was for her to leave her North Carolina and drive to a state that wasn't even her state and shimmy up a pole just like a hooligan, just like a boy. And the nerve of her to call herself a Christian, and the nerve of her to not wait until the governor and the state legislature could discuss the matter again. The nerve of her to not wait for a good debate about the issue, you know, let the emotions of the state cool down after those 9 assassinations. In an interview shortly after her arrest, Bree Newsom said this: "All people are created equal. I believe all people are endowed with their unalienable rights, endowed by the Creator." Bree Newsom said this, and she went on to say, "The people who seceded, who broke away from their country in an act of treason, who began the Confederacy, did so because they did not believe all people were created equal. But I do." "What were you saying when you were climbing the pole?" a reporter asked. "Oh," she said, "I was quoting Isaiah. What kind of fast have I chosen if not to break the yoke of oppression? And I was praying a prayer of protection over myself," she answered. Ms. Newsom will go on to talk about the moments that led up to her shimmying the pole in the name of freedom and justice. "Well, it was one of those nights just before that morning when I was wondering to myself if I had lost my mind by deciding to do this. But then I started to read the story of David and Goliath. David says, 'You come against me in my sword and spear and javelin, and I come against you in the name of the Lord.' I tell you, this world has no idea what dark energy is. I tell you, the world has no idea what dark matter can do. But I do. There is a young woman who sees herself as a child of God, just like the 9 children of God saw themselves when they invited a friend, a stranger, who became a murderer, into their sacred prayer meeting. She, Bree, made of dark matter and manners, is one who believes that she has been called to fight for justice and the oppressed, and she wants you to know this. 'For me,' she said, 'being a black woman in America, this is what this moment felt like to me. I have lived all my life in a place of dispowerment, and I didn't want to live there any longer. And this is why so many black women were climbing up the pole with Bree Newsom. And this is why all our black woman arms were stretched just beneath her as she shimmied to the top of that pole. Yes, she could hear the officers below her telling her to come down and to get off that pole in the name of the laws of South Carolina. But she decided instead to listen to the voice of David and the sound of Isaiah and hold close the manners and the dark grace of her people. So she, without hesitation, kept stretching her beautiful deltoid biceps and anconeus muscles on up the pole and on into the heavens, because her history in this America the Beautiful may indeed be the history of a woman of color who was born here and lived here in a place of dispowerment, but she refused to let that be the end of her story. Bree Newsom, our human dark energy black girl genius, shimmying and shaking the flagpole, becoming with every inch up a high energy particle in the universe, one that seeds our future galaxies. She could have waited. She could have said she was sick of it, just like me. She could have left the scene of the crime, abandoned the South, and never looked back. She could have gone on living on the planet of propriety and not on the planet of deltoid bicep and anconius. She could have believed only in Calvary as a place of religious history somewhere, somewhere over there, and not a place of reality inside of her own self. She could have not remembered that because she is a black girl genius who knows who she is, that she comes with her own black girl cavalry that is always protecting her. She could have thought the pole was too high for her to climb. She could have not practiced climbing it the day before with her friend Jimmy in order to get it right. She could have let the wheels of time roll back around in their own sweet time and left the doing to somebody else, but that's not what she did. It didn't matter to Bree Newsom that 30 minutes after it was taken down that the state of South Carolina would send a black police officer to put it back up. It didn't matter to Bree that when she was called before the court to face her crime, she would be charged by a new, young, black female judge. None of that would matter, because outside the jail where she was being kept after her arrest, with her black girl arms handcuffed behind her back like a criminal, there would wait several young black women who looked just like her, with black woman arms just like hers, who could be heard saying to the reporters there, who asked them why had they come there, well, when they looked up into the dark, unphotographable galaxy that day and saw a black woman climbing the pole to take down such an icon of hate, well, one of the women answered, well, it was one of the most liberating and beautiful things I had ever seen in my 25 years of life, right up there with the birth of my daughter, she said. The birth of my daughter. To see it come down like that, just like that, by a young, strong black woman, well, she did what our governor and our state legislature did not have the courage to do, end quote. James Baldwin said something that scared me a long time ago, something I've never said out loud. And through Bree Newsom, I have come finally to understand his words. He said, if the concept of God has any validity or any use, it can only be to make us larger, freer, and more loving. If God cannot do this, then it is time we got rid of him. And even though I usually have no problem giving James Baldwin the last word, I'm getting older, and I feel the need to add this. Whenever we step forward to be larger than our fears, freer than our unjust laws, and more loving than polite and mannerable, then a brand new galaxy has been discovered. And it is the first one that has everything each of us needs to live. Thank you.
Thank you.
Stay there. We have
there.
Something.
There. Okay. All right. Wow. Oh, no, you did. How did you know I wanted to have? Oh, my gosh. Wow. You tricked me.
When we were coming in,
unbelievable.
When we were coming in, Nikki saw this poster on just foam board and said, oh, I want one of those. And when I get it, I'm gonna put a big frame around it.
They tricked me.
And Shatika and I looked at each other and smiled. And I said, okay, that sounds like a good idea. You do not have to spend your money framing this. This is yours. Even before you do the second lecture.
Wow. Thank you so much. Oh. Thank you, dear. Wow. This is so amazing. I love this. Okay, okay.
We will do question and answer tomorrow morning after that lecture. But for tonight, there is time for food and drink and more.
Thank you for coming. Thank you for coming. Okay. Okay.